is very important in the looking at the organization of the church. It's part of God's plan. It's the way God will have things to be. And with that in mind, God set in place, he came up with criteria, amen. And we've been studying this criteria, and we're talking about the work of a bishop, or the office, as the scripture says, of a bishop, which is actually talking about the work of a bishop, and who these men are, and the deacons, who these men potentially are to be. And we've been talking about that from Timothy, and then from what Paul wrote to Titus, also about these things that are so important. And all of this comes to the benefit of the church. Everything that we're talking about is for the benefit of the church. It's not for the benefit of one man or anything like that. It's for the benefit of the church. Talking about the saving of the souls, because that's what this comes down to. Elders are to watch for our souls. Amen. They're helping us, amen, to get to heaven. And any assistance I can get in going to heaven, I welcome that assistance. Amen. So it's not something that we're going to fight against. We want to fight against, but we want to embrace in them our whole, amen, the work that these men are willing to take on and do. So in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 says, this is a true saying. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1, this is a true saying. If a man desire the office of a bishop, he desire a good work. And then it talks about the criteria, what's involved in this man. Amen. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine, no striker, not fit to drink, or fit to crave, or patient, not a brawler, not covetous, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? And this is what this is about, taking care of the Lord's church, amen? Amen? Taking care of the Lord's church. This is what this whole thing is about, having elders and deacons. It's about the fulfilling and taking care of the Lord's church. It says, moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into the reproach and the snare of the devil. Likewise, must the deacons, and it talks about the deacons here, and in Philippians, Paul talks about with the bishops and the deacons, so we know these go hand in hand. Must the deacons be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greed or fit to crave, holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. And let these also first be proved or tested, then let them use the office of a deacon on the work, being found blameless. And then it talks about the wives. And this does not exclude the wives of those who will be elders, but this is talking about the wives of both. Even so must their wives be grave, not slanderous, sober, faithful in all things. Then said, let the deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their children and their own houses well. But they that have used the office of the deacon well, purchase themselves a good degree and great boldness in the faith which is in Christ Jesus. He says, these things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. And watch this. He says, verse 15, but if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou ought to behave thyself in the house of God. This thing's talking about the house of God and the conduct of the house of God and how things ought to be handled and accomplished and done and worked out in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. Mm-hmm. So we talk about the importance of these men having this desire, they're willing to stretch. They're not going to just fall into being an elder or a deacon. They have to have a desire. They have to be willing to stretch, to reach out after, to seek after. And if that's the case, they're going to live their life. They're going to be willing to live their life in such a manner, amen, that they are qualified and prepared and willing to do the work. Must not just be expressed in words, but in deeds. And remember the key word we talked about, this is a work. So this man, what about this man? What about these men? They must be blameless. Not talking about perfect. If we're looking for perfection, we're looking for more than what God asks us to look for, amen? Talk about not having a bunch of mess that people can grab hold to. Not having a bunch of handles on us, amen, that people can grab hold to. They must be the husband of one wife. And let me remind you, we will go through these later, one at a time. so that you can ask questions and have your concerns addressed about these different qualifications. There must be the husband of one wife. Must be vigilant, temperate, cautious, guarded, careful. Must be sober-minded. All these things is describing these men. They must be of good behavior, orderly. They must be given to hospitality. They must be apt to teach, able to teach. They must be not given to wine. Leave it alone, amen. Leave it alone, stay away from it. Must not be a striker, not ready to fight all the time. And we've already gone and talked about these things to a certain degree, but we're going to go back and talk about them even further, amen. I'm just doing a recap right now, folks, we now have gotten into this. Not greed or filthy lucre or filthy earnings or filthy money. I'm trying to get it any kind of way. Saying anything goes in business and life. They must be patient, not a brawler. They must not be covetous. They must be one who rules well their own house. Because it says if they don't know how to take care of their own house, how can they take care of the house of God? They must have their children in subjection. And this helps us to understand that the children have a heart in this, amen. And this man being qualified and able to do the Lord's work, his children play an important role in this entire thing. For he must have his children in subjection with all gravity. He must lead in such a dignified manner. He must not be cruel, mean, or harsh. So his children, they cannot help, amen, but have the utmost respect for him and hold him in the highest regard. You can't make somebody respect you, amen, but you can live your life in a way that they will respect you. And this man must have lived his life in a way that his children respect him, not because of fear, of retaliation, or coercion, but because of the life that he has lived in front of them. And it must be with all gravity. This means that he leads in such a dignified manner. He's not cruel, he's not mean. This man is not harsh. His children can't help but hold him in high regard. And listen to this. The home is a proving ground. If a man can rear his children, keep order in his home, exercise loving discipline, teach his children to know and love Christ, and still maintain the utmost respect for his wife and children, this says a lot about that man. This says a lot about that man's character, because when we get behind closed doors, amen, nobody knows. I'm not an old country song. Nobody knows what goes on behind. Well, guess what? The children and the wife knows what goes on behind closed doors. They're going to know that person better than anybody else know that person. And if he can garner the respect of his children and his wife behind closed doors and move or get out in front and lead his own house, then this man is prepared to work and lead and be out front when it comes to the Lord's people. No one knows this man better than his wife and his children who live with him day and night. You want to know about somebody? Talk to their family. How those people deal with them in the house. But see, it's easy to put on that, and I mentioned this a while back, you don't have to worry about fake being, amen? You don't worry about fake being good, because for some lady, you're going to forget that you're supposed to be good, amen. But when you're just good, you're good, amen. It doesn't matter what situation you're in, you're still good, amen. So this person, if they are truly living that life, then we will see it, amen, in our interaction with them as well, amen. But if they're living a life before us, then live another one in family. I just want to know, and the family will tell. They will tell, amen. So this is a true, a proving ground, and they know him. And these men, they must have faithful children or believing children. This tells us that he must have children who have obeyed the gospel and are faithful in the Lord. And I'm not talking about little babies. We're talking about somebody who's able to have been able to believe, amen, as a faithful Christian, amen. So these children have some years on them too as well. well, amen? And when we look further into all this, we need to get a better understanding. If his children are in his home and under his supervision and his care, they must be faithful to the worship, faithful to Bible class, faithful to everything, faithful to the Lord. Amen. And parents, I say this to mothers and fathers. Parents, mothers, fathers, if you are standing in the spot and you are responsible for the raising of children, of boys and girls, I beg of you, I plead with you. If you have any responsibility toward the raising of children, if you have any hand, any doings with the raising of children, parents, I beg of you, I plead with you, let's get away from raising our children, our boys to be good sons, our daughters to be good daughters. Now, I want that to sink in. Somebody said, what in the world is he talking about? Now, I want that to sink in for a reason. That's why I'm going to say it again. If you stand in any way, in a position where you are responsible for the raising of children, parents, let's get away from raising our children, our boys to be good sons, and our daughters to be good daughters. Because here's the thing. If we just simply raise them to be good sons and good daughters, that's all they're ever going to be. Mm-hmm. That's all they're going to be. Well, I got the best son, I got the best daughter, because I raised my son to be the best son, and I raised my daughter to be the best daughter. But what happens, amen, later on in life? Well, I say, let's raise them. Not just to be good sons and good daughters, but let's raise them to be good men. Amen? Somebody, that ought to help somebody this morning. Amen. Because I just want to sit down. Right. That ought to help somebody. Let's raise them to be good men. Amen. Let's raise them to be good women. Amen. Let's raise them to be good husbands. Amen. Let's raise them to be good wives. Let's raise them to be good fathers. Amen. Let's raise them to be good mothers. Let's raise them to be good servants to the Lord. I'm going to raise my son to be a good son. I'm going to raise my daughter to be a good daughter. They're always going to be your son and your daughter. Amen. But you need to be raising them, amen, to be good men, to be good women, to be good husbands, good wives, good fathers, good mothers, good children of God, good Christians. Amen. That's going to make a difference. So you got a 50-year-old son, and he's walking around acting like a 50-year-old son, which means, Mommy, can I?
Mommy, can I?
Mama, may I? Because you raised him to be a good son, but he's a lousy father. He's a lousy husband. He's a lousy man. Amen. Let's raise them. They good sons and good daughters. That's good. But we don't want to just raise them to be good sons, good daughters. We want them to be good men and good women. Good husbands, good wives, good fathers, good mothers. That's what we want to raise them to be. You get a calf, you don't just raise a calf to be a good calf. You get a baby chick, you don't just raise it to be a good baby chick, or you want to eat it later on, amen. You want to raise it to be a good meal, amen. Be something more. That's what you want to raise them to be. Raise them to be what God will have them to be. And that involves having faithful children. Because what they see, in many cases, they will become. So we have to raise them. They have to be faithful children. And then Paul goes on to say, in Titus 1:6, not accused of riot or rudely, unruly. His children, these men, their children are not to be reckless, insubordinate children who are out of control and constantly in trouble with the law or in the community. Your child's out there running amok in the community. You can be the most faithful man in the church, but you're not going to be able to get help. That's what God says. So children, you are important. You are important to what happens with your entire family. Help your fathers. Amen? If they desire to be in this good work, supposed to do, because at the end of the day, you have a soul to lose or to win also. It's about time to get to hell. Man is only responsible for his children who are under his authority. When a child becomes a man or a woman and leaves the confines of his home, the man is no longer responsible for their behavior. There comes a time when a man or woman leaves father and mother, establishes on her own domain, Genesis 2:24. You can't hold a man accountable for what his children do out there grown and gone. We don't hold God responsible for Adam's transgression, do we? Adam messed up, we don't hold God responsible for that. God didn't have no fault in that. What about the father? Luke chapter 15, we know about that father, right? This boy, this younger son came to him and went out and became a wayward, lost soul, a righteous person, wasteful living. That father was not held accountable for that. Let's teach them so when they do leave the home, amen, while they are under our care, we're teaching them and they're respectful, they're mountable. They're faithful children to God. And then when they leave the home, we can still encourage them, amen, in that way. And I believe it's important we understand that this man, it says his children, Paul talked about the word, he meant more than one child, amen? And we'll discuss these things later. He meant more than one child that this man has. He used the plural of the word tekna, which is the plural form of the word children. And here's the idea of having this man having children. The idea is that in the house, this is the proving ground for serving as an elder in the Lord's church. Having more than one children of an accountable age presents you the challenge of having to deal with multiple personalities, resolve conflicts, and make fair judgment calls for certain those conflicts. You can't do that with just one child. Nope. If you got one child, that one child walking around the house having conflicts, amen, fussing at itself and mad at, you know, amen. But when you got children, you can learn some things. You heard that term, conflict intervention. You get a lot of experience, amen, in conflict intervention. Because children, they don't always like each other, amen. They're like mommy and dad don't always like each other. Children don't always like each other, and children, if given an opportunity, they will be like the old running coyote, or Tom and Jerry, like the cat in the mouth. They will try to kill each other when you ain't home. Amen. But having more than one child gives you the opportunity to help solve issues, to help solve problems. Because in the church, you're going to need that as an elder in the Lord's church. You're going to have to know how to solve different things that come up in the church between the members of the body. Because we always get along. We never have conflict. We never have falling out. Amen. We never have conflict. There's never arguments and disagreements in the church. And you believe that? That's most important property right here in Fort Smith. Mm-hmm. Now 17:2. But we do have problems in the church, amen. And if this man has no experience in dealing with that, and he comes into the church trying to get between two people who are having conflicts in the church, they will eat him alive. But we learn these things. And they'll learn in the home. And we talk about praying for the world, praying for the world. Let's pray for our homes, because the world is an exact result of the breakdown of the home. All those people out there in the world calling problems, they didn't just pop up, they came from somebody's home. Yeah. It's a breakdown of the home. When they threw God out of the house, amen. Yeah. They told the children, God, don't matter, so you go and do what you want to do, do what you feel. Seek after yours. Don't worry about anybody else's feelings, cares, concerns, desires. It's about you. And then they get into the world, that's what they act like. And then when you multiply it over and over and over, get what we got. Yeah. Pray for the world, that's fine. Let's pray for our homes. Because we have more influence over what happens in our homes, which means we have influence over what comes out of our homes, goes out to our communities, to our cities, to our street, to our city, to our state, to our country, to the world. Because it all starts in the home. Here's the thing. Many of us may have made mistakes at some point in our raising of our children. Why don't you just give up, amen? Don't just give up. Don't just go to child. Because at the end of the day, those children, our young people, they have souls, amen? So we still have to reach out to them and try to convince them to come back home. Like that boy in Luke chapter 15, he went out there and he cut a fool. He embarrassed that family. First of all, it was an embarrassment for him to come to the Father, talking about, give me what is due me upon your death. And not only said, I can't wait for you to die because you're not dying fast enough, so give me my cut now. And he takes that cut, the Father gives it to him, he goes out and asks a fool. But you know what that Father was at home doing? Praying for that boy. And when that boy finally came to himself, that Father ran to him when he came back home. Keep working with him. Amen. Keep praying for him, amen? Amen. They're your children. Amen. We have to be responsible for them. And it's good to sit down and have talks like this with them.
Yeah.
Have talks like this with them. Let me finish here. If that man can get out front of his house, or rule his way, or leave his house, get out front, and be able to handle the situation that come up in a home between the children who are old enough to be able to understand what they're doing, then he's prepared to deal with the things that come up in the church. Amen? Amen. Verse 6, as I prepare to close here, says, not a novice. The Greek word for novice means newly planted. Talk about this, still talk about these men, amen? This man can't be newly planted. This man who desires to be an elder cannot be one who has been recently planted, amen, or baptized. He cannot be a new convert. This man must be tested by time. He must be proven. He must be well seasoned. He must be rooted and grounded in the faith. Remember, we talked about those three P's. It is not about power, position, and what's up? Nobody paid attention. Prestige. I knew y'all paid attention because y'all thought. It's not about that. Because somebody sees being an elder or deacon in the Lord's church, it's about, man, I'll be in a position of power. I'll be in a position of prestige. I'll be in a position. I have an office, I have a title, I have some power, I have a prestigious position. If first thing like that, they're not seasoned. That's a new convert would think that way. Somebody young in the faith would think that way, not somebody who's been in the faith, amen? And that's important, because watch this. He must be time-tested, proven, well-seasoned, rooted and grounded in the faith. If you place a new convert in a position as an elder, this visible position, who has potential to, it has potential to mess with his ego, amen. It may pump him up. He may be lifted up with pride. And it will lead him into the same condemnation. And the devil, amen, will have his way. Because the devil loves people who are lifted up in pride, amen. Jesus wouldn't say, hey, look at me. Look at what I'm doing. Look at how well I'm doing this. I'm doing what you can't do. I'm in a position that you can't hold. The devil, that's his open season for the devil right there, amen. The evangelist, minister, and the congregation need to be well acquainted with this person before they become an elder. Just because a man may have served as an elder in another congregation in another city, and he had to relocate, that won't mean he automatically qualifies, amen, to be an elder. The church has to know this person. Each man has to know. The shepherd must smell like the sheep. These are men who have been amongst you, working and laboring amongst you. You know them. They know you. Amen? Why do you think Brother Bishop talks so much and has been talking so many years about establishing relationships? Getting to know one another. And those who are so really, I'm just really so private, and I really don't want people in the church to know all about my business because I'm just such a private person, and that's just me. I'm very discreet, and I don't want everybody to know about all my business and things like that. Probably watching Jerry Springer every day, Dr. Phil, Oprah, all this other stuff. People go and tell all their business. They say, well, don't show me on and tell all our business. Because we were going to tell all our business to somebody else, but then when it comes to the church, somebody who's willing to look after my soul and to pray for me and to help encourage me, I want to know what's going on in my life. That's not your business. And stuff like that. I'm not worried about your business, I'm worried about your soul. And if you're concerned about your soul, you may not worry about me knowing a little about your business, because your business may involve something that's going to jeopardize your soul. So at the end of the day, what should it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own business? Don't say that. What should it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what will a man be willing to give his change for his soul? I'd be willing to give up a little bit of my business in exchange for my soul. And Jesus said, well, better not good and faith service. That's the things to think about. But this man needs to know the people. The people need to know these men. And the last thing I want to talk about here as I close, verse 7. Have a good report of them which are without. This means that this man cannot live a double life. He doesn't act one way around the saints of God and another way around those in the world. He so lives that his unconverted neighbors, co-workers, associates, boss, or employees have a good testimony concerning him. You know, ran somebody in the store somewhere and you get to talking to them and stuff. You know, sometimes you keep in the store, they'll tell you their whole life while in the checkout line. But then sometimes you find out that you know the same people. And they're, you know, where do you go? Where do you worship at? Remember the Main Street Church of Christ? Oh, you know, what you call? Yeah. Oh, boy. I work with what you call. People would tell. They feel good. Amen. That should think will make you look bad. So we must have a good report of those in the body and those outside the body. Now, there are people who will just make up stuff on you, amen? We're not going to be naive. There are people who will make up stuff on you because they don't like it. But we have to be wise, amen? And love says, this is verse chapter 13, when it talks about love, the description of love. Love holds all things, believes all things. Love don't just take everything and, you know, hey, this is my little sissy talking about. You got some proof here. Amen? I think I'm going to back up. Okay, so exactly what did they do? Well, nothing. Okay. Amen. So there are people who will just kind of throw some things out there. They say about a dog with a care of bones, he'll bring a bone to one, amen? But these men must have a good report, not living a double life. Must be a good testimony concerning him. So this is not something that a man is just up overnight just decided to do. This is the life he's been living, amen? This is the life this man has been living in the home. This is the life this man has been living on the job. This is the life he's been living in the community. This is the life he's been living before the church. These are the men that the church will be looking for, amen? These are the men. And this all goes back to the saving or the overseeing or the watching out for your soul. So it's something that requires diligence, it requires thought, it requires discernment. Amen. Amen. And just because somebody makes every service, amen, that's not what it stops at. Make every service. That's good. Be a part of what's going on. That's good. But what about out? Amen? And when you know people, you know what's going on in their lives. Amen? The shepherd must smell like the sheep. The shepherd must smell like the sheep. And with that, I'm closing this morning. If this making sense, is this going to be beneficial to us? Because a lot of churches, they just jump up and say, okay, this guy, he's president of the bank, this guy, he has his own law firm, this guy here, he has his own business, so we want them to be ours. And me and I, I'm not ready. Well, you know, you're a good banker, you got a good business owner and stuff, and things like that. And here's another thing I need to make sure we understand about elders and deacons. It's in particular the elders. Elders are not elders to be finance managers and things like that. Their job, amen, their work is to watching out for the souls. Amen? So those elders and real elders will do this. You guys, you are over the finances for the church, you handle that ministry, you handle that work. I'm watching for the souls. Elders ain't worried about trying to sign papers and things and loans and things like that. That's not an elder's job. You have to watch for souls. You have deacons, you have other brothers in the church with capabilities to do those things. The elder's job is to watch for the soul. So here's the thing. This man may be, his occupation is a janitor. Maybe he's a retired janitor. Not glamorous, anything like that, not anything prestigious. But this man can watch for souls. He's a faithful servant to the Lord. He's sincere. He's raised his children. His wife respects him. He has to respect other church. This man can do well. But you have the banker, amen. This one you have the banker, and his children are all under the muck. His wife can't never shut up. Amen. She got to be in everything. He's constantly causing trouble and problems. He's not qualified to be there. So we're not looking at what they do as far as their position in life and things like that, their occupation. We're not looking for that. We're looking for men who meet these qualifications, who have a desire, who know the congregation knows them, and he is ready to do the work. Amen? That's what we're looking for. And we cannot lose sight of that. So it's not about this man's position and bank account and all that stuff. It's about this man's work, this man's life. And we will be prayerful about this, amen? And opportunity will come. We'll be able to have classes and you can address it. And I know you got questions, concerns coming. That's great. That's what we want. So we can help get those questions answered, amen? Because it's all about the saving of the soul. And speaking about the saving of the souls, Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. The greatest story ever told. The greatest story ever told involves what God did for us. He so loved us that he sent his only begotten Son. The Son died for the sins of the world. They took him out. I believe about 33 and a half years. They took him out, and they put him on a cross, and on that cross he died. And he shed blood on that cross. And they took him off that cross, and they buried him in that grave, and on the third day he died. And he told his disciples, you go into all the world and tell this story. It's the greatest story ever told. He said, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. He that believes not shall be lost, shall be damned. So these men, they went out and they told the story. That's what we're telling us today, the same story. Nothing's changed. First Corinthians 15, 1 through 4 lays out the facts of the gospel, the death, the burial, and the resurrection. That's what it's going to take in order for a man to be saved and obey that. How do you obey that? You must be willing to hear. You heard it this morning. Do you believe it? If you believe it, if you can sit right where you are and repent, God will change your mind about what you believed before, what you've been a part of, you can repent right where you are. And then you can say, you know what? Ready to become a child of God. And that tells me that you're ready to confess with your mouth before his audience that you believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He's the Son of God. And that's the question that we ask when you ask chapter 8. Same thing that was asked of the eunuch. He said, I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And if you answer that question in the affirmative, we will take you and baptize you in the water, your sins will be washed away, you will get the Holy Spirit, rise from all the new life, you add to the family of God, and then you'll be faithful unto death. He says, I need a crown of life. It's as simple as that. None of the other stuff that the world is teaching, all that foolishness out there, doesn't involve any of that. It's simply obeying the gospel of Christ. Obeying the gospel, that's what it comes down to. Come back to it. And being faithful unto death. If you're here this morning, you're not a child of God, you want to become one, the invitation is yours. If you're here this morning, the child of God, you prefer yourself or someone else, make that known as well as we stand and sing this song to the church.